This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book, The Science of Real Estate and Mortgage Investment by Homer Reed. Introductory. The real property with which this monograph deals generally lies east of the Rocky Mountains, west of the Alleghenies, and north of the 35th parallel of latitude. As the writer is a Kansas City man, the point of view is that derived largely from an experience of 18 years in the investment of money in and about Kansas City in both Missouri and Kansas. These investments have had to do with property bought for income and with property bought for speculation, with city, suburban, country town and farm loans, involving the careful consideration of real estate as security for mortgage indebtedness. While the personal experience of the writer is confined almost entirely to the classes of real estate already enumerated in Kansas City and in the country immediately tributary to it, yet, as the experience of one western city and its environs is much like that of an other, what is true of Kansas City is measurably true of Chicago, St. Louis, Minneapolis, St. Paul, Omaha, Denver, and all other western cities. What is true of farming lands in Missouri and eastern Kansas applies with slight modifications to farming lands in Illinois, Iowa, Nebraska, and in the middle northern states generally. The rain belt, which, generally speaking, may be said to extend about 200 miles west of Kansas City, that is, to a north and south line running through Salina, Kansas, marks the western limits of farming lands, in the correct use of that term, that is, of lands of high fertility in a climate suited to the production of miscellaneous crops of cereals and vegetables, notably to the production of wheat, corn, and potatoes. The belt of country westward of such a line extending to the Rocky Mountains falls under the head of ranch or grazing lands. It is estimated that between the years 1885 and 1890, $200 million of eastern capital was invested through mortgage loans in the Missouri Valley and tributary western country. The ignorance of investors, the lack of common sense on the part of local agents, coupled with a world's finin sale panic and a senseless sudden withdrawal of funds from the West by eastern investors, even when safely invested, and that too, when the loaner had no use for the money, led to a temporary collapse of land values in the West, which caused disaster to both lender and borrower. Thus, what should have proven a blessing to all parties concerned proved calamitous even where the loaning business was conducted with honesty and good judgment, and converted what had been friendly business relations of East and West into those of mutual suspicion and disgust. The object of this monograph is to call the attention of investors, both East and West, to the fact that real estate and real estate mortgage investment are a science, that the main features may be stated in a simple way, and that when stated, they are so obvious that they are easy of comprehension and their application in actual business practicable. Two points of view. One is that of the purchaser who buys with a definite object, as for income use or speculation. The other is that of the loaner upon real estate security, who considers only the possibility of ownership in the event of default and foreclosure to satisfy the mortgage indebtedness. In the following discussion, the first point of view will be adhered to until all the different classes of real estate have passed under review. An additional chapter will be devoted to the differences which should be borne in mind in estimating real estate with the view of direct purchase and estimating it as a sound security for debt. As this dissertation is dignified with the name of science, an attempt will be made to find general principles of wide application. While these principles may seem to be accompanied by many apparent exceptions, yet unless general principles of wide application can be discovered, then all claims to having reduced real estate investment to a science must be abandoned. Classification of real estate. The kinds of real property most commonly coming to our view as commodity-seeking purchasers are mineral lands, timbered lands, farms, grazing or ranch lands, city, suburban and country town property. These will be discussed in their order. Mineral lands. As a new country is settled, the first lands to attract attention are those of greatest natural fertility, especially those which are well watered. Gradually, the settlements extend to the less fertile lands, but still lands sufficiently productive to warrant clearing and fencing and bringing into pasturage or cultivation. Thus, gradually, all lands which at a moderate outlay of labor can be made to pay fair returns to labor and capital are taken up by homestead entry or purchase, and co-occupied for general farming purposes or for grazing. When this process has continued for a time, there is generally a residuum of rough, rocky or barren lands, sometimes sparsely wooded, which are not sufficiently productive of forage to warrant the expense of fencing for ranch or grazing purposes. These rough lands generally contain a good deal of mineral and are known in real estate circles as mineral lands. If there is some timber scattered over the land, they would be preferably called timbered lands because of better market value. As a rule, these so-called mineral lands have scattered timber on them but generally of no commercial value. Timber must be good and the stumpage heavy to make it pay to run railway tracks to the lands in order to carry the logs to mill or market, or to warrant the expense necessary in marketing the timber in any other way. As a rule, timbered lands are good for agricultural purposes after the timber is removed. But generally, when anyone offers the so-called mineral lands for sale, we may be certain that when we go to look at the property, we shall see something which is worthless for farm and grazing purposes, land whose timber is so small and scattering as to be of little value and which is probably absolutely worthless, but which passes from one dupe to another by trade and sale, deluded by the mere possibility of finding paying quantities of zinc, lead, iron, copper, gold or silver. A possibility which the imaginative and not over-scrupulous real estate broker often transforms by his picturesque language into a high degree of probability and even certainty. There are millions of acres of such lands in Pennsylvania, Virginia, Kentucky, Tennessee, Missouri, Arkansas, and in fact all over the Union. These lands are more easily handled in the West than in the East. The Eastern investor, being more experienced in these absolutely worthless wastes, knows better what to avoid than his more credulous because less experienced Western cousins. As a matter of fact, these lands are generally thrown in as a part of an exchange, sometimes causing people to think they are getting something for an equity or some other questionable property which they are giving in exchange. In reality, they are getting less than nothing, because they are getting a property which will never produce a dollar, but upon which taxes must be paid. I say will never produce a dollar, I mean unless the purchaser can find another dupe who will give something for that which will never produce anything, but which will always be taxed. There is, of course, the remote possibility that something valuable in mineral may someday be developed, but these so-called mineral lands are rarely ever developed to see what there is in them, as they are trading lands, pure and simple, and rarely fall into the hands of anyone who has any inclination to see what they contain. Of course, men who want genuine mineral lands go to districts already developed and, after due examination, purchase what they want and pay the market value. This applies to iron, lead, zinc, silver, and gold mines. These investments are one thing and the so-called mineral lands which float like driftwood from one trader to another are quite another thing. In other words, if you want to mine, buy mining property, but don't buy it until you have developed it and know what you are buying, unless you buy some original claim at a nominal sum. In the mining regions of Colorado, it is customary to bond mines. That is, the proposed purchaser takes an option of purchasing the claim within 1 or 2 years at set price if he finds paying ore. If he does had such ore, he only loses what he spends in hunting for ore. He does not buy and pay for the mine until it is proven to contain valuable deposits of mineral worth working. So if you want to go into the mining business, search until you find valuable ore. But do not buy 80 called mineral lands until you know they contain mineral in paying quantities. These lands at first look seem cheap, often being offered at from a few cents to a few dollars per acre. As a rule, Such lands should be approached by the investor with extreme wariness and suspicion, and should only be purchased after a personal inspection or on a report of examination by a reliable expert. As legitimate investments to be considered by the average investor, they should be dismissed as unworthy of serious attention. Timbered lands. Here we come to a much more attractive property. Their value is apparent on casual inspection. Their timber value and the agricultural value of the lands after the timber is removed are easily ascertained. The character of the timber, whether sawstuff, tie stuff, or other sorts, can be estimated by timber experts, certain men being professional timber hunters and spending large portions of their lives in making examinations, estimates, and reports to be used as the basis of purchase by persons seeking such investments. But even here, much timbered land which looks tempting to the casual investor has no attractions for the experienced lumberman. A natural and easy division of timbered lands is into two general classes, those which have a fertile and arable soil so that they may be used for farming purposes after the timber is removed, and those which, when the timber is removed, are worthless or of little value for such use. Many lands naturally fertile are worthless for farming purposes on account of occasional overflows or some other natural defect. Many investors who buy timbered lands make a specialty of buying only those lands which, when cleared, are valuable for farming purposes. As a rule, such lands can be bought for what they are worth when cleared, and all that can be realized out of the timber is clear profit. Investments in timber have two serious drawbacks: fire and theft. Almost every section of the United States is from time to time visited with continuous drought, and at such periods immense forest fires often rage and pine lands especially suffer greatly. Then too, if your timber tract is near enough to transpiration so that it is immediately profitable to cut and ship the logs, unless a constant watch is kept on the lands, the choicest trees will be cut and hauled out by men who know what they are about. It is hard to convict these timber poachers because it is generally in a sparsely settled district, where the people are quite in sympathy with the poor wood chopper, and then too, if an arrest is made, it will always be made to appear that the prisoner had a permit to cut timber by someone, somewhere, and that he mistook the boundary lines and supposed he had the owner's permission. It is often the loss of a few fine trees per acre which makes the difference between first and second class timbered lands. Thus, if a person would invest in timbered lands, he has many things to consider. First, will the lands when cleared be valuable for farm purposes? Second, is the land convenient to railroads so the product can be easily marketed? Third, if not near a railroad, what are the probabilities of its being reached by railroad, and will it probably be in 5 or 25 years? Fourth, is the timber of a staple kind or is it a fancy wood like black walnut which was much in vogue a few years ago but which now is quite out of fashion? Fifth, is the local supply many years ahead of the demand? This equation is often disturbed by the caprices of the trade. A few years ago, mahogany and cherry were much sought after. Soon after, the trade was flooded with stained imitations made largely of white maple. Previous to this time, white maple was mostly used for firewood, but its demand for use as imitation mahogany and cherry was just like finding that much new timber available for the manufacture of furniture. About this time, as black walnut was becoming dear and scarce, the prevailing style of furniture suddenly went to light woods, to ash, red and white oak, elm and maple. Heretofore, elm and red oak were considered almost worthless woods, but this change of fashion caused these hitherto useless woods to supplant to the extent of their use white oak, walnut and cherry, which had the same effect on the price of the furniture woods formerly used as though new and extensive forests of furniture woods had been discovered. This is not true of either yellow pine or white pine, which have general use as dimension lumber and most other common uses. Lastly, if one would invest in timbered lands, he should first be sure that he has a trustworthy local agent who can see that his choicest trees are not stolen. The careful estimate of the value of timbered lands belongs to experts, Persons who have had careful training and can not only travel the forest and give an accurate estimate of the stumpage, but who have had enough commercial experience in manufacturing and marketing the product to judge of the value of the standing timber for immediate use, and also to judge, if the time has not come for immediate use, the probable length of time it will be necessary to wait before the timber can be profitably marketed. In conclusion, I would urge that investment in timbered lands requires personal investigation, preceded by carefully acquired knowledge and long deliberation, that it is a special branch of real estate in which deception is easily practiced and in which many favorable conditions must concur in order that the investment be satisfactory or even ultimately profitable. There is in this class of lands a good field for profitable investment. There are probably in southern Missouri, Arkansas, and Georgia, and farther down the Mississippi, as good opportunities as exist in the world for intelligent investment by the experienced, but woe to the uninitiated who listens to the gossamer which the land agent often weaves like unto a spider web in which to catch the investing fly. Farming lands. The discussion of mineral and timbered lands was introduced to make the classification complete and to point out clearly that they were matters for the specialist, rather than for the general aral investor. We now come to the branch of real estate by far the most extensive and legitimate which will pass under our view. The first characteristic of these lands which we may appropriately discuss is their limited area. With the people of the United States, until very recently, this was not the case. As long as good lands in eastern Kansas and Nebraska were open to homestead entry or could be purchased at the government price of $1.25 per acre, there was no pressure of population on tillable area.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.